Kia ora. Ngā mihi nui ki a tātou katoa I rungi I te ngoa o tō tātou Riki o Ihi Koraiti. A very warm welcome to our church service today. How good is it that through Christ our Saviour, we know the one true and living God, and His Holy Spirit is in our hearts, and we can worship Him together today and be part of that one big family of God. Let's hear from Psalm 103. Praise the Lord, my soul, all my inmost being, praise His holy name. Praise the Lord, my soul, and forget not all His benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for the oppressed. He made known His ways to Moses, His deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will He harbor His anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is His love for those who fear Him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us. As a father who has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear Him. For He knows how we are formed. He remembers that we're dust. The life of mortals is like grass. They flourish like a flower of the field. The wind blows over it, and it's gone, and its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear Him, and His righteousness with their children's children, with those who keep His covenant and remember to obey His precepts. The Lord has established His throne in heaven, and His kingdom rules over all. Praise the Lord, you His angels, you mighty ones who do His bidding, who obey His word. Praise the Lord, all His heavenly hosts, you His servants who do His will. Praise the Lord, all His works, and everywhere in His dominion. Praise the Lord, my soul. Let's pray. Holy Lord God, God Almighty, God of infinite power, God of awesome majesty, God of utter holiness, of extraordinary compassion, mercy, and grace, we praise your name. Let everything in our inmost being honor you and worship you and bless your holy name. We thank you for blessing us every day. We thank you for salvation and new life through Jesus. We thank you for your word and for your Holy Spirit. We thank you for the strength and the hope we have in you. And we come to you today in our human weakness and frailty, looking to you for comfort and healing and refreshing. We come to you in our human sinfulness, looking to you for forgiveness and for strength to live as would please you. We know that for as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is His love for those who fear Him. As far as the east is from the west, so far do you remove our transgressions from us. And we've just read too that you are compassionate and gracious and slow to anger and abounding in love. So thank you for your forgiveness, which we are so assured of through being one with Jesus. Lord, come near to us again as we worship you today. Help us to listen to the voice of your Spirit and to respond to you in spirit and in truth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hi there. So as you can see, it was a bit too windy outside to do the videoing, so we've come inside. But what I wanted to show was my beautiful daffodils. And although this may not be the last week of lockdown, it is the last week of winter and spring is coming. So these daffodils, they remind me of a poem, a famous poem written by William Wordsworth about daffodils. Now, William Wordsworth was a poet in England in the early 1800s. And Paul and I have been to his house, which is in the Lake District, very beautiful over there. And I thought that today I'd tell you this story about this poem, which is my favourite poem, when I was a teenager in Wellington. So when I was 15 years old, I had a crush on a boy in my class, my fifth form English class. And he was handsome and smart and funny and kind and quite shy. And I had no idea if he even knew that I existed. But one day, the English teacher said that we all had to choose and memorize a poem for our school certificate English exam. And we all had to say it in front of everybody so that he could check that it was suitable and that we knew it off by heart. So the day came and we all sat in a circle in the classroom, and the teacher pointed to me, and so I said this poem about daffodils by William Wordsworth, and I can still remember it today. I wandered lonely as a cloud that floats on high o'er vales and hills, when all at once I saw a crowd, a host of golden daffodils, beside the lake, beneath the trees, fluttering and dancing in the breeze. Continuous as the stars that shine and twinkle in the Milky Way, they stretched a never-ending line along the margin of a bay. 10,000 saw I at a glance, tossing their heads in sprightly dance. And so the poem goes on, there's two more verses. And the teacher said, yep, that was very good, that would be suitable for the School C English exam. And then we carried on around the room, everyone taking their turns, until it came to the boy that I liked. And when it was his turn, he started saying his poem. And it was something like, softly, gently, moonlight falls upon the cool and peaceful waters, or something. But as he started to say it, I thought it sounded a bit familiar, and then I realised it was actually a poem that I had written, and it had been published in the school magazine the year before, and he had found it and memorised it and was saying it in front of the whole English class. And so I thought that was so romantic. And then when he finished, the teacher said to him, oh, who was that poem by? And he looked down at the floor and he looked across at me. And then he said to the teacher, oh, I can't remember. And the teacher said, well, make sure you find out, because that would be a good one for the School C English exam. So now I knew that he knew that I existed. And the following week was our school certificate maths mock exam. And that week I was violently ill. I was very sick with a gastro bug and I didn't make it to the test. And this was highly unusual. That later on that day, I got a knock at the door, and it's the friend of the boy that I like. And he's delivering me a handwritten note. Now, in those days, there weren't emails or texts or Snapchats or Instagrams or Facebook. Okay, it was a handwritten note, and we got our friends to deliver it. And so when I read it, it was a poem. And it was a poem that this boy I liked had written for me. And it was sort of to the pattern of roses are red, violets are blue, sugar is sweet, and so are you. But it wasn't exactly those words. You wouldn't really understand them, because in our year level at school, we had our own special sort of made up language and words that was sort of had lots of in-jokes. So you wouldn't understand, but the gist of it was, you must be really sick if you missed out on school, and please bounce back real quick and come back to school. And it was signed Concerned Little Fish. And Fish was his nickname, because everyone got given nicknames, and he was really good at rugby. He was on the first 15, and he was good at dodging and slippery like a fish. So everyone called him Fish. And he also gave me a king-size bar of chocolate. So that was very romantic. And yeah, we ended up going out with each other. But I think it's really special if there's a poem that's written for you or about you. And I'm wondering if you like poetry. And what this is bringing me to is a challenge that I have for all you kids and actually everyone out there in our church whānau. And that is that next Sunday is Father's Day. And so I thought it would be really cool if we could think about writing a poem. And more specifically, a haiku, because that's a very short poem. It's from Japan and it just has three lines. And very basically, because there's a lot more to it, but basically the first line has five syllables, the second line has seven syllables, and the third line has five syllables. And a haiku's essence is to concisely capture a moment and a feeling to reflect on. So, if you could write a haiku, it could be about your father, your earthly father, your dad, or our heavenly father, God. And it could be any sort of feeling. It could be funny, it could be sad, it could be poignant. And so it's not just for you kids, it's for anyone. And if you could send me your haiku by Wednesday midnight, that's the 1st of September, first day of spring, that would be great. And I can get a selection and to read for next week's Father's Day service. So I've got some examples of haiku here. See if you can guess what sort of feeling that they are expressing. Dad, you're full of quirks. There is no one just like you, except future me. Empty coffee cup sitting upon the table reminds me of Dad. Stars, planets and moons, like grandparents, aunts, cousins, my own galaxy. God can do all things. My life is falling apart. I choose to love him. So as you can see, I don't think that there's any haiku in the Bible, but there are poetry books in the Bible. And there's actually up to a third of the Bible is poetry, would you believe? Different types of poetry. And I'm wondering if any of you can think of some of the books in the Bible that are mainly poetry. We have Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, and Job. And in an email that I've sent out to the Kids Time whānau today is an online Kids Time lesson about Job. And so I hope you enjoy that. He's a very interesting character, Job, who suffered a lot and wondered why, and that's what that book is about. So don't forget to start thinking about if you can write a haiku for our Father's Day Haiku Challenge 2021 this week. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for the beautiful imagery and poetry that there is in the Bible. Thank you that you love us, that you care for us. Lord, may us writing a haiku be a distraction from all the worries of the world and be an enjoyable experience this week. Lord, keep everyone safe. I pray a blessing on all our families, Lord, that we may be a blessing to others. In Jesus' name, amen. Ka kite anō.
See the kids.
Well, just two notices today. First of all, next week, after our normal online church service, like this one, we're going to try and have a Zoom cafe. That is, after about a 5-minute break, we'll do 20 minutes or so of interaction, of fellowship on Zoom after the service, so we can all fellowship and talk with others. So it may be chaos or it may be really good, but we're going to give it a go. So we'll send you the link towards the end of next week. So if you're able and available and you want to join with others on Zoom for that time of fellowship next week, that would be excellent. The other thing I want to mention is a bit more serious. It's this current select committee process in relation to the Conversion Practices Prohibition Legislation Bill. Now, this bill would make it a criminal offence for anyone to perform any harmful practice intended to change or suppress a person's sexual orientation, gender identity, or gender expression. Now, obviously, neither the church nor the state should ever be involved in any type of counselling or therapy with anyone on any subject that's harsh or harmful, disrespectful, coercive, or against somebody's will. And as Christians, of course, we must love and respect everyone and respect their choices. But many people are concerned about some aspects of this bill. And one of them is that a parent who advises or seeks to dissuade their child from gender transitioning could potentially be committing an offence. Another is that if somebody who is living in one sort of or other of LGBT lifestyle, or who has transitioned and then wants to detransition, decides they want to turn away from where they've been or where they are and go to some trusted person such as a counsellor or a mental health professional, a youth worker or a pastor, and wants to explore it with them, and those people who are giving them assistance or support or advice to explore that what might mean and how they could get to where they want to go could be potentially committing an offence. A third area is that of religious freedom. Churches would still be, according to the bill, be able to teach biblical ethics about sexuality and gender, but if they offered any actual pastoral counselling or prayer to support somebody who wanted to make such a change, those persons who are helping them and offering support could potentially be committing an offence. So it's really quite tricky. So do be in prayer about this. Also consider making a brief, thoughtful submission. And I just want to say to you, submissions are due by 8th of September. Now you may find more information on this matter and guidelines on how to make a submission by going to the website of the New Zealand Christian Network. It's very easy to find. Just go to Google or whatever and write in New Zealand Christian Network. It'll bring you to the front of that website and there you can find the information you need. Let's now join in prayer for others. Let us pray. Almighty God, we bring before you the needs of our society. We pray in particular for the fight against COVID, and we pray for those seeking to contain the disease, those who need to make wise decisions about the fight against COVID, for doctors and nurses, for those who are seriously ill with the disease, for those who are suffering hardships of separation or loneliness or of economic hardship, for those who are overwhelmed by anxiety. Lord, we pray for the struggles in countries elsewhere where there's much more dire circumstances. And Lord, we pray for you to have mercy on this globe fighting this pandemic. Lord, we pray for countries where there is great suffering for other reasons. We pray for Afghanistan, and we see the great fear there, and the atrocious bloodshed that was committed this week, past. We pray for Christian minorities, for people of other faiths, and those whose lives are in great danger. And we pray for them. We pray, Lord, for Myanmar, where it's gone off the radar with the news, and yet there remains repression and fear and great danger to many people. We pray, Lord, for North Korea, and we pray, Lord, for the beleaguered believers in you in that country. We pray, Lord, for Haiti, where there's been disease and earthquake, and Lord, there has been a great suffering and poverty. And Lord, we pray for all these places and others where there's great suffering, that you might help those who help others, and that you might comfort your people and extend mercy to all, we pray. And Lord, we pray for New Zealand, that our churches may be strong in both love and in faith. We pray that the hearts of many people in our society may turn to you, and that we may see the spiritual tide change in this nation. And we pray that we, in this and every other church, may be faithful followers of Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Morning, Massey Riverhead Presbyterian Church. We are currently in the midst of another lockdown, and as the name suggests, that can be quite a bit of a downer. And so as I prayed and asked people and thought about what to speak today, I thought I'd share some of my favorite encouraging stories from the Bible that tell us what God is really like and how awesome God really is. But before I get there, let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for today, and I pray that as I speak, anything that is of me would fall away, and anything that is of you would resonate in the hearts of those hearing this today. In your name we pray, amen. Now, before I share the stories, I just need to give a little introduction, starting with Hebrews 1:3. And Hebrews 1:3 says this: "In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom also he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. And after he had provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven." Now, what Hebrews is saying here is that Jesus is the exact representation of the very being of God, which means if you have questions like, who is God? What is God like? How will God respond to you? What is God's character like? What angers God? Where does God extend mercy? If you have those questions, you need to look at the person of Jesus for the answers. Because Jesus is the key if you want to know who God is. Now, of course, we can learn things about God from other places. There are insights from creation, from your conscience, and other parts of the Bible. But if you want to get to the very heart and character of God, you need to look at Jesus. If Jesus isn't at the center of how you think about God, your ideas about God are going to throw you off. And the way we know what God's nature and character is like is by looking at the person and work of Jesus. And so I want to look at three quick stories about Jesus that I love, so as to get an insight into the awesome God we worship and follow. Now, the first thing I want us to learn about God through Jesus is that God is merciful. And we know God is merciful because we see Jesus constantly bestowing mercy to people who are clearly guilty. And one of the best places this is shown is in John chapter 8, where we have the story of the woman caught in adultery. So here's the story. One morning, she is dragged into the temple while Jesus is teaching, and she is thrown at his feet. And the Pharisees and the teachers of the law ask him, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery, and the law of Moses commands us to stone such women. Now, what do you say?" And then the story starts, giving us all these weird details that has caused endless speculation. You know, don't worry, I'm not going to give you my speculations. But the story says Jesus bends down and he starts drawing in the dirt. And nobody has any idea why he was drawing in the dirt. I mean, there could have been all sorts of things. I mean, some people say he was drawing their sins in the dirt. He could have been drawing a picture of a narwhal. I don't know. I have no idea. But Jesus draws in the dirt, and then he tells everyone, "Let any one of you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her." And then Jesus goes back to drawing his narwhal. And then it happens. The reason why this story is in every single Jesus film ever made. I mean, Mel Gibson even included it in The Passion of the Christ, even though this story is nowhere near or in Jesus' Passion accounts. You know, Mel used a flashback. So the text says that starting, and this is beautiful, starting with the oldest and then going to the youngest, they all drop their stones and leave. And then Jesus stands up and asks her, "Where are they? Has no one condemned you?" And she says, "No one, sir." And he says, "Then neither do I condemn you. Go now and leave your life of sin." And what makes this so spectacular is that she is guilty. I mean, this woman was caught in the act, the actual act, and the law is clear. It condemns her. There is no question here. And yet Jesus puts his life on the line to provide mercy for this woman who is blatantly guilty. And so what we learn about God by seeing the Son is that God is merciful. Or how about the story of Zacchaeus the tax collector in Luke chapter 19, who, being a tax collector, is the poster boy for worthless piece of human rubbish. Right? Tax collectors were considered incredibly wicked, wicked, wicked people. And they bought the right from Rome to raise taxes for Rome, which helped pay for the army which had conquered the Jewish nation and was responsible for the murder and rape of thousands of people. And they were considered, tax collectors were considered betrayers of their own people, and they were not the type of person you wanted to be associated with. And so in our story, Zacchaeus climbs up a tree to see Jesus because he's a wee little man, right? And can't see over the heads of the crowds. And Jesus walks by the tree and stops and he looks up and he says to this tax collector, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." And so Zacchaeus, climbs down and him and Jesus go to his house while the crowd mumbles how Jesus is eating at the house of a sinner. And while there, they talk about the gospel, about reconciliation. They talk about God, and Zacchaeus has this traumatic turnaround. He repents and not only returns all that he has taken, but gives back more, saying, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anyone out of anything, I will pay them back four times the amount." And Jesus responds by saying, "Today, salvation has come to this house." And so what we continuously see in the life of Jesus is that in the face of people who are blatantly guilty, shameful, or have a disregard for anything having to do with God, Jesus' response to them is to give mercy, which then prompts those people who receive that mercy to pursue repentance, which is a changing of their own personal ways to the ways of God. And so what we know about God through Jesus is that God is happy and quick to give mercy to those who ask for it, desire it, who want it. And we know this because we constantly see that those who receive Jesus receive mercy, grace, and love. And we also see through Jesus that God is compassionate. And one of the best examples of this is in a very interesting and complex story in the Gospel of John. In John 11, Mary and Martha, two women followers of Jesus, send a message to Jesus that Lazarus, someone whom Jesus loved, had taken ill and was close to dying. And in response to this, Jesus tells his disciples that this sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it. Which is an interesting, though complex, idea. But instead of leaving right away, Jesus stays for two more days teaching. He then decides to go on the journey to see Lazarus back in Judea, which is already a couple of days' trek from where he is currently on the other side of the Jordan River. And once he gets near, however, Martha runs out to meet him and is not happy. You know, she's probably sobbing and she says, "Where were you? If you had been here, my brother would not have died." And Lazarus isn't just dead. He's dead, dead, buried in the ground, dead. And so with Martha crying, Jesus walks with her to the village of Bethany, where Lazarus is buried. Now, Martha goes and calls Mary to come see Jesus. And so Mary quickly leaves her house full of people who are mourning. And the mourners, thinking she's going to Lazarus' tomb to continue mourning, follow her out. But Mary is going to see Jesus. And so Jesus is confronted with this mass of weeping and wailing people. And out of that mass comes Mary, who says the same thing as Martha. "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." And Jesus, in response, asks, "Where have you laid him?" And so this large, devastated crowd of people that are sobbing and crying head to the tomb. Now, remember, why is Jesus going to this tomb? Jesus is going to raise Lazarus from the dead. Right? There's nothing to suggest that he's changed his mind. He's already told his disciples, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." Jesus knows that he's about to raise Lazarus from the dead. He's walking with this crowd of people who are devastated, crushed, destroyed, broken, in pain, who are mourning and don't see any light at the end of the tunnel. And then this absolutely fascinating thing happens. It's known as the shortest verse in the Bible. What happens? Jesus weeps. He starts crying. John tells us that Jesus is also feeling the pain. And this is where we get the really interesting but complex idea we talked about earlier. An idea which is also very beautiful. Jesus knows that he's about to raise Lazarus from the dead. He knows that in just a few moments, he's about to start a celebration of the likes that this town has never seen. Lazarus has been dead for 4 days. That's way different than bringing someone back after 10 minutes. This isn't CPR. This is dead as a doornail. And so Jesus knows what he's about to do. But even though he has this knowledge, this doesn't stop Jesus from entering into the grief of his people. And so we learn through Jesus that God is compassionate. Even though Jesus knows he's going to raise Lazarus from the dead, he still has compassion on those who are experiencing grief experiencing loss, who are mourning, who are in pain. He doesn't say to those currently in pain, "Look, look, look, it looks bad close up, but pull away and you'll see this beautiful tapestry." Which is true enough, but instead, he just starts mourning with them. And then he raises Lazarus from the dead and starts a party like they've never seen. And so we know God is compassionate because we see Jesus being compassionate in the face of his hurting people. Now, if you really want to see what God is like, you really need to put yourself in these stories. I mean, imagine being the characters in these gospel stories about Jesus and his mercy and compassion. Think about what's really going on when they drag that woman caught in the act of adultery and throw her in front of Jesus. Is she in tears? She's pretty confident that she's going to die. In her mind, this day is going to finish with her lover escaping and her being showered with rocks until she dies publicly. It's about as awful a way to die as anyone can imagine. And that's the world she lives in at that moment. And what does she receive? Mercy. She receives mercy from Jesus. Or how about Zacchaeus? This guy just wants to see Jesus. Zacchaeus doesn't want Jesus to see him. He's hiding in a tree. And Jesus talking to Zacchaeus makes everyone in that city go crazy in anger. He doesn't want Jesus to see him. He just wants to see Jesus. But Jesus shows him mercy. And finally, Mary and Martha. Everyone is in shock when they see the compassion of Jesus. See how he loved Lazarus. But as the famous Anglican minister John Stott pointed out, true, we don't know the reason God allows evil and suffering to continue, but we know what the reason isn't, what it can't be. It can't be that he doesn't love us. It can't be that he doesn't care. God so loved us and hates suffering that he was willing to come down and get involved in it, to die on the cross for it. And so what we see is if we put ourselves in the gospel story, we begin to feel the weight of the love and grace of Jesus. When we look at his life, we can begin to get insight into the wonderful God that we worship. Now, these are just three of the many beautiful stories about Jesus. Three that really resonate with me, that really show me what God is like, and thus what I should be like, filled with forgiveness and compassion for my neighbor, friends, family, church, and yes, even enemies. And I encourage all of us to truly experience and remember the story of Jesus and what it means about how much God loves us and cares for us. Ask yourself, where have I been shown mercy? Where have I been shown compassion and love? And remember the goodness of those who have treated you with mercy and compassion and love. Remember the goodness and love and compassion and mercy of God. And then ask, is there anywhere in my life right now where I should be showing mercy or compassion or love to someone? Maybe now is the time to do it. And for those of you who are watching or listening and may not consider yourself a Christian, welcome. Thank you for joining us today. You are loved. And I pray you would embrace the beautiful story of Jesus like so many else have. Thank you, everyone. I hope you have an excellent week. And hopefully this lockdown ends sooner rather than later. Blessings to you, peace upon you, and God bless.
have your eyes upon Jesus. A fool in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glorious grace.
Let's close with this reading and prayer from Ephesians 3. For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.